thousands of tributes. It was interesting what Mr. Burgh was telling us a moment ago, that it was the crowd that was here outside the Abbey that began the applause at the end of Charles Spencer's tribute to his sister, that led those at the west door of the Abbey to start clapping, and finally it rippled right down the nave so that the whole Abbey was doing something that nobody would have predicted they'd done, which was to applaud the words he said, that it all began out here on the streets. Now, I've been joined here by another close friend of the princess, and somebody who I suppose will never be forgotten for the dance that he did with her at Covent Garden, Wayne Sleep. And you, like Christopher Burgh, were in the Abbey this morning. What were your feelings as you listened to that service?
I thought it was brilliantly put together. I was worried that it was going to be a bit stuffy in some ways, and that's exactly what she wasn't, and that's what she was totally against, all red tape, all sorts of things. She was a very brave woman in that she went her own way, knowing that she'd be criticised for it. That's the point I think I'd like to make as well when I was sitting there. And when Elton sang that song, it seemed to fit in totally with the rest of the hymns and everything. And when her brother made that speech, I'm afraid that's when I really went and, a bit out of control myself, I'm afraid. And because I was remembering when he was talking about her and his relationship with her, of some of the things he said were applied to how I felt about her when she used to double up with laughter when we were rehearsed together. She would always say, as we were going down an official lineup, you know, when you wear another hat, it has to be work, and she was a very professional woman. But, you know, she'd whisper something in my ear to crease me up, knowing that I couldn't laugh, and look back at me and sort of wink, you know, and say, you know, and then I would tell her a joke or something. She said, no, I'll do the jokes, you know, and sort of pass on. It was always tongue-in-cheek, you know, and then there was a more serious side to her, of course. And I'd like to also say that the dance world, when I was sitting there, I thought, the dance world has lost such a loyal person to help them. I mean, the English National Ballet, she was their patron. I mean, they
she
were
never
so
she never abandoned them, did she?
No.
They were one of the six charities she kept going last year.
Yes, and I know there are so many other causes in the world that are more important humanely, but, you know, without dance, you know, we wouldn't have our entertainment. And she was so good. All the dancers throughout the world must be really sad that she's gone, because they know that that was her number one love in recreation. And she even trained with my ballet mistress, and that's how we got to dance together. You know, and it's just well, the penny really hasn't dropped yet. Even it's too early to say.
It's an interesting gift that she was able to cross all these worlds, that she could move in the world of music and ballet and enjoy that and support it, and at the same time show the same kind of interest and affection and care for people suffering from leprosy or for people who've been injured with landmines. It was a very broad appeal. And she wasn't, interestingly, didn't feel she had to concentrate on the so-called serious issues and abandon the ones that were fun. The two could go together.
And that's where she was very brave, because she knew that she would get ridiculed if she'd done something serious one week and then decided to dance with me, for instance, the next on Covent Garden stage. And, you know, people would say, well, she isn't serious at all. And she knew she was going to come under attack for that. But she's a human being, and a human life is all about joy and giving and love and having a bit of everything, you know, and she wasn't afraid to show that.
Christopher, were you surprised by that side of her character, or intrigued by it, perhaps?
No, I liked that also very much, but she wasn't scared to put her heart on her sleeve. Just like Wayne was saying, you know, the establishment could have knocked her down and tried to many, many times, but what the people loved about her, she was one of them. She was saying, you know, ah, what the hell, you know. So tradition is tradition, but this is the way I feel. And it wasn't done with a brass neck or arrogance. On the contrary, it was done with humility. And that's why the people are so devastated by her death.
Just tell me one thing. You live in Ireland, and the Irish government has announced that flags would fly at half-mast today, and they've been holding services. Did she have the same kind of strength of appeal in Ireland as she did in the United Kingdom?
I'm very proud to say that in Ireland, yes, their reaction to this tragedy has been as impressive as it has been anywhere in the world. Irish people adored her, and in fact outside the British Embassy all week there have been flowers and condolence books have been signed. Irish people, I think, also recognized in her that she had this gift of transcending barriers with the love that she had inside, and Irish people are as devastated as any other people in the world.
Wayne, how do you think this memory of her will last for people? Do you think it will change people who've witnessed the events of this week, and particularly the events of today? Do you think that kind of sudden spark of inspiration or sudden surge of public feeling is something that endures?
Yes, it for a while, but it has to be fed, and you have to be reminded of it constantly in order for it to keep succeeding. She was, I would think it would be a wonderful tribute to her that if many of the things she wanted accomplished while she was alive could be accomplished almost because of her death. You know, like landmines, if this brought the world together and made an effect on them, then she would be really thrilled that even after her life, she still had some way and sway in persuading people to do the right thing.
Thank you very much, Wayne Sleep. Thank you, Mr. Burgh. The royal cars are now coming towards Althorp House, having just done the 5-mile journey from the station.
I don't know what I'll get. Oh, just a little while on the view.
And the convoy of cars bringing the immediate family are now approaching Althorp Park. They're coming the opposite way to the hearse, so there's only a few people on this side. They weren't expecting anybody to come by. And they're turning into the grounds which were designed by one of capability, Brown's landscape gardeners. Very peaceful place, and one quite well known to Prince Charles, because it was after all here where he first met the then Lady Diana Spencer, when he was here meeting one of her sisters.
Now, I've been promising a visit to Scotland, where of course the morning has been very intense and there have been services during the week. But let's go to Glasgow now and join Jane Frankie and hear what has happened there today. In Edinburgh, I think she is.
Jane. Well, just like everywhere else, Scotland has been still this morning, still and emotionally charged. In towns and cities throughout the country, flowers have been piled up at civic buildings. There have been and are to be services of remembrance. Here in the shadow of Edinburgh Castle, there was a special service this morning. The Westminster service was seen on large screens. The Scottish Secretary, Donald Dewar, was here with other dignitaries, people from all walks of life, all ages, and from the charities the Princess supported.
An unusually still.
Just as the bells at Westminster pealed the end of the minute silence in London, it was broken here by a lone piper, the flowers of the forest. More than 1,500 braved a bitterly cold wind to be here this morning. And as I said, a bitterly cold service this morning, a very moving one. Lord Provost Eric Milligan of Edinburgh led the service or welcomed people here. Why was it so important to have Edinburgh's own special service?
I think there's two reasons, Jane. One was that the Edinburgh people themselves